Penguin Random House Audio presents The Kingdom of Sweets, a novel of the Nutcracker by Erika Johansen. Read for you by Grace Gray. For Maya Ziv, who goes into the quicksand with me every time. Overture. Everyone called him Godfather. When Clara and I were christened, he came to the ceremony, though he was no relation of ours, and stood in the back of the church, leaning on his cane, grinning like a reaper as we were baptized. He wore a swirling blue cloak like that of a sorcerer in an old tale, the silken lining spangled with moon and stars, and everyone feared him. Our cook, Anastasia, who hailed from the countryside, even said he had the evil eye. Our parents had not invited him to the christening, but because he attended, they had no choice but to invite him to the small reception at their home. They hoped he wouldn't accept the invitation, but he did, handing my father a handsome present of gold coin before he proceeded to the corner where Clara and I lay comfortably in our cradles, staring up at the ceiling. We were the first Christmas babies that year, born shortly after midnight on the holy day, and the midwives had thought us identical. But it would never be that way again. Drosselmeyer stood over our twin cradles for a long moment, staring down at us, despite our father's nervous attempts to lure him away with offers of cigars and brandy. When he placed one hand on each of our foreheads in the old pagan sign of blessing, our mother began to weep. "Light," Drosselmeyer said, looking down at Clara, and then, turning to me, "Dark." My mother screamed, then fainted dead away. Father and his friends tried to pull Drosselmeyer from my cradle, but he laughed and raised his cane. Darkness fell upon the room, and in the commotion afterward, people rushing to and from the kitchen seeking matches and extra lamps, Father fetching mother's medicine and assisting her to a sofa, it was some minutes before they realized that Drosselmeyer had disappeared, vanishing like one of his tricks. But he was not entirely gone, for in the entrance hall of our house, they soon found his other gift, a portrait of the man himself, sitting in a high-backed armchair. This portrait could not be removed. Father tried, even hired carpenters to make the attempt, but the frame defeated all comers. Nor could the portrait be hidden, for no matter what mother chose to wrap it in, cotton or sheeting or linen, the covering would inevitably fall while the house slept, and the maids would find it in the morning, crumpled on the floor. Thus did Drosselmeyer watch over us, even in the dark. Father and mother begged the guests to say nothing of what had occurred, but to no avail. The tale spread far and wide throughout the city. Such a celebrated piece of legend that soon no one, not even my parents, recalled which friend or relative had actually stood over us at our christening and pledged to care for us if they could not. We had only one godfather, and everyone knew his name. Light, dark. This became the tale of our childhood. Light, they called Clara, and rightly so, for Clara was all that was bright and charming, blue-eyed and pink-cheeked. Her bouncing curls reflected the sunlight in golden spangles. When she spoke, the lilting charm of her voice enticed others to listen, making her sound far more intelligent than she really was. She lived in the moment, not understanding why anyone should wish to look beyond, and because most people honestly did not wish to do so, Clara was both popular and well-liked. Lucky as well, they said, for the blessing of a wizard was no small thing. Drosselmeyer never attended another christening in the city. And though no one knew why he had come to ours, our family was assumed to be under a kind of protection. So Clara was invited everywhere, to birthdays and soirees and parties and lunches. She was a wildly decorative jewel in our society, and her dance card was always full. I was the dark child. The unlucky child. My hair fell black and straight down my back, and my face turned broad and dull. As we left childhood, Dropping our necklines and tightening our stays, Clara developed a pretty figure, with full breasts and long waist, while I remained short and lump-like. I sat in the corner at dances, watching Clara move, living through her life. Being born on Christmas Day was supposed to be a lucky omen, but our friends and neighbours assigned that luck only to Clara, while I was considered fundamentally unlucky. Once I overheard Mrs. Ladd, the railroad magnate's wife, telling the baker that she would rather cross paths with a black cat than that cursed Stahlbaum child. The rest of the neighbourhood must have felt the same, for I was never bullied or mistreated by the other children, only left alone. I did not believe myself cursed, but I could not deny that Drosselmeyer had done something to me, opened my eyes wide. Clara never saw the way boys' faces would change when she turned elsewhere, their smiles becoming hungry and wild. She never saw our father curse in his beard at the rich men who snubbed him in the street, or the brittle disappointment that lay behind our mother's fixed smile. Clara could not see the hidden darkness of the world, but I could. I was cursed to see. Grandmother Kalinov, the oldest woman in our neighborhood, said that I had the evil eye, just like Drosselmeyer, that I could look into a man's heart and know his most terrible secrets. I saw the hidden contempt of husband for wife and wife for husband, the fear of the merchant whose business was collapsing, a mother's jealousy of her daughter's youth. They did not trust me, our friends and neighbors, for they knew I knew them, and people don't wish to be known. They need their secrets, just as they need their illusions, and so although I was christened Natasha, having been born first on Christmas Day, they called me the Dark Sister, and I was as distrusted as Clara was praised. Still, we were friends, Clara and I. We squabbled often, but we were loyal. We needed each other, for our parents were never the same after the christening. Mother grew increasingly dependent on the unseen world, her days dominated by mediums and spiritualists as she sought some way to undo what Drosselmeyer had done. Father took his own regrets out of the house, and so often it was only Clara and me, supervised first by nursemaids and then, as we grew older, tutors. When we were four, our brother Fritz was born, and he was christened without incident. My parents held the ceremony at home, and the priest did not begin to speak until Father had locked all the windows and doors. After our christening, Drosselmeyer reappeared in the neighborhood wearing an eye patch. The neighbors said that he had offered his right eye to the dark powers in return for help with his sorcery. There had always been such tales. Drosselmeyer dealing with the devil to curse this or that associate who had crossed him, or to delay his own old age. Drosselmeyer had come to the city long before my parents' marriage, and he was not young even then. But he still walked the streets with the easy movements of a man in his prime. The loss of an eye did not appear to discomfort him either, for he went steadily about his business, doing strange favors and piling up debt, the most dangerous kind of debt, not only of money but of service. By the time Clara and I came out into society at 14, most of our neighborhood seemed to owe Drosselmeyer in one way or another. And even our own father was forced to beg a loan when one of his foundries suffered a collapse. Thus did we join the legion of families who lived under Drosselmeyer's thumb. No one tried to cheat him, for he always seemed to know things he had no business knowing. And no one quite understood the limits of his strange power. Mrs. Armistead, one of my mother's more foolish friends, said that Drosselmeyer had threatened to turn her nephew into a toad. But people lost interest in the story when she admitted that he had never made good on his threat. Still, no one was quite certain that Drosselmeyer could not do such a thing if he wished, and so no one dared test him. He prowled our neighborhood at all hours, so they said, practicing his dark art. And on nights when I was wakeful, I would sometimes peek around the edge of my velvet curtains, hoping to see him down there on the snow-covered path, surrounded by the clutch of gilded boys he kept to do odd errands. And I did see him once, wearing only his top hat and cape in spite of the cold, striding up our street with his boys hollering and baying like a pack of wolves bewitched by the full moon. But no one called the constables, for everyone knew that even the constabulary resided comfortably in Drosselmeyer's pocket.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.